About 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I got a phone call, and it was from one of my aunts, Dorothy, and she said, "I'm phoning you because your mum can't speak to you. She's rather upset. We're in the hospital at the moment in Blackpool, and your father's been taken ill, and I'm afraid things look rather bad." I have to say that I had a magical childhood, and my father was the gentlest of fathers. A lot of people have stern father figures. Some have no father figure at all. They're left to more or less bring themselves up. But in my case, I wasn't in awe of him as a father figure, because he was my best pal as well. Forever.
So we brought him home, and Michael was marvellous. He did absolutely everything for him, and I helped, of course. But so he was about 8 months like that at home, and then he suddenly took a little turn for the worse. And the doctor came and said he'd, you know, he didn't think he had long. And so after a few days, the doctor had to come again. He said, "I'm sorry, but he's not going to get well." So I think it was that night. He was very, very poorly. And I leaned over to him and I said, he couldn't speak, well, hardly speak. And I said, "Say I love you." And he said, "Say I love you." And he said, "I love you." And I swear his lips never moved. A ventriloquist to the end.
Here is the greatest ventriloquist in all the world, England's Arthur Worsley. Arthur, it's so very nice to have you back on our show. How's the little fella?
Oh, I'm great, Ed. Great.
Oh, I understood he was a little nervous.
Oh, he's nervous. I'm all right.
Well, you don't have...
he's nervous.
You tell him he's got nothing to worry about.
Yeah, see what I mean? Son, look at me when I'm talking. Don't gaze away.
As a ventriloquist, well, what can I say if you mentioned the great painters of the past, that's open to contention. Who was better than who, or chemists, or inventors? Everybody's got their own ideas on who was better, composers, say, music composers, who was better, who people like more. But when it comes to ventriloquists, it had seemed that it's irrefutable that he was anything other than the greatest the world's ever seen.
Well, is there some one word or vowel or any sound that's most difficult for a ventriloquist to produce?
Could I answer you, Mr. Sullivan?
Yeah.
Speaking on behalf of this young lad standing here, I've had him for many years, and I want to tell you that the hardest letter could a ventriloquist is the letter G. That's the hardest. The letter G. I can say Broadway, Gronks, Brooklyn, Gaggley Hills, Guccalo, and Goston, but what I really want to know is, son, say a gottelagia without moving your mouth. Go on. Say a gottelagia. Say a gottelagia without moving your mouth. Say it! How is it, son, that when I shout, you spit in my face? Say, I've got to look here. You can't do it, can you?
When I was younger, and Charlie was the same age, I can't say I disliked him or hated him, but I was certainly frightened of him. When he's 3 foot tall, almost exactly, and when you're the same height, and he sits next to you, or shouts or something, you know. It's, as you can imagine, it's terrifying. He'd ask me something and not let me alone until I answered. So I was always very quick to answer him. Whatever it was he asked me, I was there with an answer, because that meant an end to it, because it was really, I really didn't enjoy it.
Charlie's very selfish. I don't think he cares too much about Arthur at all. I think that he sees as far as to the end of the next joke, and he kind of protects everything that is needed to carry on with his act. Therefore, he's constantly making sure everything's all right. Where's he been that day? Where's he going to be going later? How did his mother bring him up? Does he feel all right now? And onwards, he has this constant questioning.
Son, look at me when I'm talking, don't gaze away. There's only two things in life to worry about. Only two things. Whether you're going to live or whether you're going to die. If you live, you've got nothing to worry about. And if you die, you've only got two things to worry about. Whether you go to heaven or whether you go down below. If you go to heaven, boy, you've got nothing to worry about. If you go down below, you're so busy shaking hands with all your old pals, you haven't time.
After the funeral, we all came back to the house. Somebody started to say something about Arthur over a drink, you know, toast him. And I said, hold on a second, because there's somebody who should be here. So I came up the stairs and got Charlie out of the suitcase and brought him down and sat him amongst us. And he's been downstairs with us ever since.
I saw him sort of doing these things and sort of get a chair being positioned, and Charlie put on, and I said, what are you doing? And he didn't tell me, except he said, oh, well, you'll like it. I said, what is it? He said, never mind, you'll like it. And that's all he would tell me. And I saw this chair being set up in the corner, and Charlie being placed on it, and his mouth just propped down a little. What's he doing? I thought, well, I won't interfere, I won't say anything. But my word, when I saw the finished product, I thought it was marvellous. I thought it was really very, very good indeed. And we, I think, must be unique, really, because we had quite a few replies to a Christmas card.
My attitude to Charlie changed when I grew up a little and saw him as what Charlie's always told me he is, and he's told everybody else, that he's made of wood. So who could be frightened of that? Actually, I think he's rather lovely, don't you? Charlie's part of home. He's not only part of my past memories, but he's also part of my dad. And while Charlie's around, he's a constant reminder of Arthur and how much we miss him.
Hello, Charlie. Right up down.
I was saying that I regret not having children now. Because, in a way, when people have said to me in the past, you've not got children, but children are your future. And I used to think when I was younger, well, they might be my future, but they'd certainly deal with the present. You know, I couldn't do any of the things that I might consider doing if you've got school fees and uniforms and hospital visits and whatever to... however much it costs to bring children up. But now, I can see maybe what they meant. Because as you lose people through the years, I can see having children as being a consolation. Not a consolation prize, but something to console you losing the people you love.
Now listen to this.
When you're smiling, you find the whole world smiles with you. And when you're laughing, really laughing, well, the sun comes shining right through. But when you're crying, well, it brings on the rain, so stop your crying. Be happy.
Just a minute. We all know, ladies and gentlemen, the thoughts just struck me in the day. We all know that the hardest letter for a ventriloquist is the letter G. We all know that.